present the news quiz with your host, Miles Jupp.
Hello. And welcome to the news quiz, and indeed welcome to 2017, which we hope will be every inch the non-stop festival of fun that 2016 was. We start with something from an article about Van Gogh in The Guardian, read by Caroline Nichols.
Van Gogh was bleeding copiously after slashing his ear with a razor, so he wrapped the piece of ear in paper and walked to his favourite brothel, where he gave it to a young woman he knew.
Thanks to Mark Hopcroft from Malvern for keeping us up to date with that. Now, let's meet the teams. Will you welcome first on my right, Jeremy Hardy and Angela Barnes. And opposite them, on my left, Danny Finkelstein and Andy Parsons. So, Jeremy, who's resigned to our fate?
Sir Ivan Rogers, who was our ambassador to the EU. There's quite a lot to get through here, and it is quite dry, so let's crack on. Basically, he led our negotiation. He's loathed by Brexiteers. He's a predatory Europhile. And he's hated. And the hatred started when he led our renegotiation of our membership of the EU with Cameron. And he was warned by Ivan Rogers that it wouldn't go well. European leaders are not going to just give us what we want. He keeps giving this advice to ministers, and this has made him very unpopular. He's denounced by Brexiteers as being a gloomy pessimist. But, you know, I thought the referendum was supposed to be about more than the bottom line, about more than trade and money, and I thought it was about who we are. And who we are is gloomy pessimists. That's our national characteristics. What defines us is a defiant and chipper resignation about the absolute crapness of life. And no Brussels bureaucrat should ever take that away from me, nor any perky Atlanticist. Anyways, it's got to the point that Sir Ivan Rogers is so upset with being ignored and clearly upset that civil services advice is not being taken that he has resigned. And his resignation letter was part saying, look, I'm leaving because my predecessor needs time to get into the post. But also there was a parting shot where he criticised ministers for not listening to civil servants and he championed civil servants. And I tend to feel quite sorry for civil servants because they are the people who basically run the country while ministers fanny around saying, look at me, I'm important, trying to make up for the love they didn't receive when they were backbenchers. And so he's really upset a lot of people on the Brexit wing of the Tory party, including Peter Lilly, who condemned the resignation letter, and also Irritable Duncan Syndrome pitched in. But the new man is another sir, but they're very pleased. Davis and Johnson are very pleased about the new Barrow man, just in that way that you would be when you've got absolutely no idea what you're doing and somebody turns up. It's like when British Gas arrive, they might not stop water pouring through the ceiling, but, you know, they take two sugars, so there's a stronger chance that they'll be able to fix it than you will. So we've now got this new sir in charge. And all sorts of people have chipped in. Farage! Nigel Farage. You have to feel sorry for Paul Nuttall because no one cares what he thinks. And he must ring the BBC saying, hello, it's Paul Nuttall here. I'm the new leader of UKIP. And, you know, if you ever want any of my opinions on anything, and they say, oh, look, is your dad there? Yeah, okay. Nigel, I want to speak to you.
To the job, didn't he, Farage?
Oh, yeah, he thought they would send him, because you would do that, wouldn't you, in a diplomatic role.
But he thought that about everything. It's like he really doesn't know what to do with himself now, does he? He sort of turned up in America, decided he'd start doing a job there no one asked him to do. He's like the bloke who cleans your windscreen at traffic lights.
And will you personally miss Ivan Rogers, Andy?
Well, his trouble was, and he said that there was going to be... said it might take 10 years for us to negotiate Brexit. And nobody liked this, did they? David Davis going, well, he said, we'll be able to do it. He said, as long as we're nimble, we should be able to do it in 2 years. And you're thinking, well, if there was a word that you were going to use to describe Boris Johnson, nimble would not be it. We all saw what happened when he was playing rugby, what happened to that small Japanese kid. If Boris Johnson was in a China shop, the bull would be found innocent.
Yeah. where does this leave us all, then?
Well, I was quite amused that he was called permanent representative. He's not that permanent. It didn't yeah. I don't think actually being in the EU that turned out to be that permanent. But it was a bit confusing, that story, because basically, as far as I can see, he said he couldn't remain because he's worried about us leaving. And then people who want to leave don't want him to remain because they're worried that if he remains, we won't leave. But now that he has left, the problem of leaving remains. So I'm not sure I followed the story.
I'm not sure why people are surprised. He's basically he's the bloke who's decided to sell his ticket to the Titanic, isn't it? It's not because he says in his resignation letter, he's pointed to the fact that the government don't really know what they're doing over Brexit. You know, that we're wandering into this Brexit like we're wandering into the back of a wardrobe, and at the moment we don't know if it's Narnia or just a stack of old pornos. That's, I mean, either way, Boris Johnson's happy, but we don't know.
I suppose the idea is that, you know, he's an expert, isn't it? It's almost like he's a builder, and the government is saying...
Had enough of the experts, Miles, haven't we? We've had enough.
That's a wall. You just need to take the wall down. And he's saying, well, I don't want to take the wall down. It's a structural wall. But they're saying, no, well, we want you to take the wall down. The people have spoken. Take down the wall. We need to put an RSJ. And, yeah, the people have had enough of RSJs or whatever it is.
It's not going that well for Theresa May, is it? I think she's finally realised that maybe it wasn't such a good idea. She's had this long strategy. You know, her school friend said, oh, she always wanted to be prime minister, and she's played a game. We're making sure she's got no enemies in the party. Everybody kind of likes her. She's kind of liked on both wings of the Tory party. It wasn't really clear what she thought about Brexit. She played it very carefully so that she would become leader, and now she's leader. And you look at her and you think, you've realised that none of it was really worth it, haven't you, really, Theresa? It's a bit like when you get your kitchen done and the builders leave and you look around and you realise your problem never really was the kitchen.
Indistinguishably, this is the news that Sir Ivan Rogers is to resign as Britain's permanent representative to the European Union. What I want to know is what kind of man resigns the day after coming back from Christmas break? You've had 2 weeks off, Ivan. Get your face out of the panettone. Go back to sodding work. Sir Ivan was expected to carry on in his current role until October, but felt that a better way to prepare for Brexit was to spend the next 9 months stockpiling tinned food and dragging mattresses into a cellar. Sir Ivan left with a note to his staff, which is rather uncommon when leaving a role. I'd much rather he be frog-marched out by security as he kicks and struggles, calling Karen from HR a snide bitch who's wanted this from day one. 2 points to Jeremy. Angela, whose prices are off the rails?
So, this is the story that train fares have risen by an average of 2.3% in the UK, and we now pay on average six times more for our season tickets for our rail fare than our European peers. So, for example, if you're a season ticket holder in Luton, say commuting to London, you pay an average of £387 a month, whereas for the equivalent distance in Paris, they pay £61 a month, and they don't have to live in Luton. I had to go to Glasgow before Christmas, right? It's true. And I was a last minute replacement for someone at a show in Glasgow, and it cost me £250 to get to Glasgow and back, right? You double that if you buy a sandwich, right? It cost Tim Peake less to go to work than it cost me.
It's funny you should say that, Angela, because I had to go to Glasgow and I looked and the standard off-peak to Glasgow was £134 by train. And if you can fly to Barcelona for £40. If you've got a meeting in Glasgow, it shouldn't be cheaper to fly yourself out to Barcelona and then fly from Barcelona to Glasgow. But possibly even better than that, if you've got a meeting in Glasgow, right, actually just fly yourself out to Barcelona for £40. Whoever you're meeting in Glasgow, fly them out to Barcelona.
My brother went to a conference in Glasgow and went back with somebody from the conference. On the way back, the train inspector came and asked the guy for his ticket. He searched, he couldn't find it anywhere. Train inspector decided to let him off. He arrived home, told his wife that he'd had this terrible journey, come back on the train from Glasgow, hadn't had his ticket, and his wife said, "That's great, but what did you do with our car?"
Happening with the trains, don't you? I mean, Theresa May, the one thing that she has approved, isn't she? 50 million for high speed rail link 2, so as we can get from Birmingham to London 20 minutes quicker. And I have absolutely no confidence that we won't actually get to London 20 minutes quicker, but be kept just outside of London for 20 minutes waiting for a platform to become available. And then just as you start going.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books,
Use the link in the video description.